Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Complaint line is open. Just give you Matt's cell number here. It's 570. No, I'm just kidding. Welcome to the show. Great to have you with us. What? Brought to you by our good friends at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. And online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, best of new inventory, great pre-owned inventory, all with the Sunbury Motors guarantee. Your trade-in's never been worth more. And a great service department. Inspections, routine, difficult. They handle all of it. It is one-stop vehicle shopping. That's why they have so much repeat business. It is from stem to stern the best. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia. Routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf online at sunburymotors.com. Our play-by-play call of the day, an old friend hits one in the clutch.
Kalscher stopped by Anderson. Swing it. Brockington. Count it. A triple. Hunter, one of those Cyclones in double digits with 18. To go with four assists. Brockington yet again. Ice in his veins.
Thrill for Zay. You heard the other name, Kalscher. That's Gabe Kalscher, who played at Minnesota for 3 years. Ames is the land of opportunity for transfers, always has been. But Isaiah Brockington is having an outstanding season for Iowa State. All right, so let's change gears. Ben Roethlisberger announced his retirement. Every time we kept thinking about Pittsburgh, and there was a retirement that was going to be announced, and, if somebody like associated with the Steelers, a whole bunch of us made the wrong assumption. I mean, because we had a party all set up for tonight in Sealands Grove, and then we found out it was Roethlisberger, and it wasn't the guy we thought was going to retire.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
To be honest with you, a whole bunch of it had harbored hope. All right. But with that, let's bring in Chris Mack from Pittsburgh. Welcome, sir. Great to have you back.
Good to be with you, Steve.
So let's get to Ben Roethlisberger. I know I brought this up last week, but let's just revisit. Because the relevancy, we just talked about the Patriots, relevant for two decades. Mm-hmm. Belichick, Brady, Packers relevant for a couple decades, Favre to Rodgers. And the Steelers, whether it was Coward to Tomlin, but also Roethlisberger was the constant during this two-decade run. The reality is he was their best player almost the entire time.
And what I think is interesting when we think about parallels, he wanted to emulate John Elway as a kid. John Elway was one of his quarterbacking heroes. That's why he chose number 7. And when I look at it now, Elway, as successful as he was at the end of his career, was always sort of a second, third fiddle to the Montanas and Marinos of the world, even though Marino never won a championship. And Ben, I think, ultimately is going to end up going down. Look, he's a hero to so many Steelers fans, but I think when you look at his career and the entire two-decade arc of it as compared to Brady and Manning, he'll end up going down as sort of a second or third fiddle to those guys. And I think similar to Elway, you'll always wonder, well, what if he had not been a part of that great era of quarterbacks, And I think that's probably a proper perspective to put Roethlisberger in. Is first ballot Hall of Famer, 2-time Super Bowl champ, a very exclusive club in that regard. But certainly, it's got to be tough when you're as good as Roethlisberger was, or you're as good even as Manning was, or like I mentioned, Elway, but you weren't even the best of your generation, you know? So it's an interesting legacy he'll leave behind, and certainly with everything else going on here in Pittsburgh, given the status of the GM, the status of the possible heir apparents to the GM, and all the other things going on, it'll be interesting to see how they move forward from this.
Yeah, moving forward eventually is going to be the key to all this. But Roethlisberger, did he do a good job of rehabilitating his off the field image? Because obviously now with his wife, his children, mm-hmm. you see them around him all the time. Did he eventually rehabilitate his off field image?
I think as well as you can, given how poor his off field image was in the first 5 years, 6 years of his career. You know, when you consider, and it wasn't just the sexual assault allegations in Georgia or Nevada, it was just the way he carried himself around Pittsburgh. He was boorish, to put it simply. He was inconvenienced by most people who were around him, who weren't pretty girls. He acted like a 22, 23, 24-year-old kid who had just won two Super Bowls and was more or less handed the keys to one of the most storied franchises in North American sports history. And I think he wasn't ready for that. Maybe if he's a guy who had gone to a bigger program in college, who had had more media attention on him in college, who had been a little more polished, he wouldn't have fallen into those traps. Maybe he would have anyway, and that's just his personality and the apparent rehabilitation we've seen over the last 8 to 10 years is just that. It's a perception rather than reality. But I think for the most part, fans have been willing to forgive the way he acted years ago, because it did come to a stop seemingly. And and that was the biggest concern. You know, that story, I'm not sure if you've seen it yet this morning, about that Mike Singletary claims, you know, the Niners were close to acquiring Roethlisberger around the time of his troubles in Georgia. I remember distinctly advocating on the air way back then that they should consider moving on from Roethlisberger, mm-hmm. In favor of a younger quarterback. And it sounds like they were very close, perhaps, to doing that, or at least the 49ers and Mike Singletary believed they were close to pulling the trigger on it way back when. It was at that point. People were ready to be done with him here in Pittsburgh, despite two Super Bowls and all the talent he had. We were ready to be done with him. And the fact that he brought it all the way back around for a lot of those people to, in the final couple years of his career, being willing to more or less hit pause on the organizational development that's going on all around him so they can more or less have a walk-off into the sunset year for him. That's I think, rehabilitation, image rehabilitation enough for most fans.
What turned it around for him? Was it a realization like, hey, man, I got to stop. I'm wearing out my welcome. Or was it getting married?
I think, well, a little bit of both. I think his wife, Ashley, did help settle him down. Obviously, he wasn't going out and partying anymore, or if he was, it was limited to, you know, going out with the guys on his team, and it wasn't really a party anymore. He did become more of a homebody, at least, again, according to public perception. But I think, you know, that moment when he did question whether he was going to remain with the Pittsburgh Steelers. Mm-hmm. He had to sit out those first four games of the 2010 season. That was like a 2x4 upside the head, I think. And I think that, more than anything, was the wake-up call. Listen, you win two Super Bowls. Like I said, you're flying high. You're a mm-hmm. young guy in your early to mid-20s, and the world is in the palm of your hand, seemingly. And then you realize that it could all be gone in an instant. And I think that, more than anything, is what woke him up. And, you know, if it were a different organization that at the time had not had the same sort of father figure in place in Dan Rooney, mm-hmm. I don't know. You know, Mr. Rooney is a guy who so many players in that organization, and before him his father, Art, I'm sure you've talked to Jack about this before in the past.
Sure.
They played for him, you know?
Oh, yeah.
It was to honor the Rooney name as much as it was to honor the Steelers' name. And I think when Ben Roethlisberger realized the dishonor he was bringing to the Rooney name as much as the Steelers name and his own name, I think that helped wake him up.
Big. Now they have to move forward. They never really did draft a successor. There's no Jordan Love on the roster. Let me think about that for a moment. I didn't like him at Utah State. What kind of speculation is there going to be in the city? And in fact, Kenny Pickett has played the last few years in the city. Does that at least enter into the mindsets of the fan base? I'm not talking about Kevin Colbert, but the fan base.
The fans, yes, certainly. For those fans that are both Pitt Panthers fans and Steelers fans, they love that idea. But they also don't think there's a good chance that Pickett will make it the 20th overall. Now, if the stuff that we've seen in Denver today is any indication, it wouldn't be surprising to see Aaron Rodgers end up with the Broncos now, which would take them off the board for a quarterback, certainly, and might help Pickett slide a little farther. I still don't know if he slides to 20, but maybe Matt Corral slides to 20. And I think those two are probably near the top of the list if the Steelers are keeping an eye on quarterbacks who might fall into their lap at that point. But I don't think they're going to go out of their way to draft a quarterback in the first round. I don't think they'd move up. I think if they're sitting at 20 and the quarterbacks are off the board, they'll take an offensive lineman. If the offensive lineman and the quarterbacks are off the board, they'll just look elsewhere. It's not like they don't have other holes they could fill in the draft. As for quarterback, I'd be pretty surprised if they don't bring in a veteran to challenge, sort of a borderline starting quarterback style veteran to challenge Rudolph and Haskins and just provide a little bit of an insurance policy, you know, whether that's a Trubisky or a Minshew or, I don't know, a Bridgewater type, I don't know. But all those guys apparently are available to be had. I don't know if they go so far as to trade a first round pick for, you know, a Jimmy Garoppolo, certainly, or a Derek Carr. And I don't think they're going to realistically be in the Rodgers sweepstakes. So I think, you know, it'll probably be a veteran stopgap to come along and provide, like I said, a little bit of insurance and also a little bit of a competitive push to Rudolph and Haskins. They'll try and rebuild all the other spots on the roster that need fortifying. And then if they go 7-10 and end up getting themselves a top 15 pick in 23, well, that's when you can look at your, you know, your Bryce Loves and some other possibilities. Or Bryce Young, pardon me, and other possibilities going into that draft.
Okay. Is the Steeler fan base, are they able to accept 7-10?
If they know that there's a payoff, I think they will. If 7-10 were to include, you know, trading for a Jimmy Garoppolo, like I said, or bringing in a more established veteran quarterback rather than a stopgap of sorts, then they would certainly not be satisfied with that. 7-10, I think fans will be able to swallow if they know that there's a payoff on the other end of it. And I think that would be the question. I think a lot of them would be willing to take that step back for just a year, 7-10, 6-11, whatever it may be, because that's what had to happen the last time to secure a franchise quarterback. They had to go 6-10 in order to get the pick where they were when they drafted Roethlisberger. And I think everyone realizes that your best chance to get a franchise quarterback, it's not exclusive, but your best chance to get a franchise quarterback is top 10, top 12 in the draft.
Well, it's been quite a run for him, quite a run for the Steelers. And now the next step comes up.
Yeah, and that's the thing, Steve. They did, like I said, more or less hit pause on their organizational development for a year in order to honor Roethlisberger with one final season. And whether you believe that was the plan all along, or perhaps they made an offer to Roethlisberger that they thought he would turn down and he ended up accepting it and they were stuck between a rock and a hard place, they've not only hit pause on the development of the organization based on, you know, just honoring Roethlisberger for a year, but also at a time when Kevin Colbert, as I mentioned before, may decide to retire after the draft.
Right.
He's apparently seriously considering that. And Brandon Hunt, who would be the heir apparent, may take a job with the Raiders or anybody else who may interview him for a GM position. Omar Khan's been interviewed by the Bears, amongst other teams in the last couple of years. He would be the other guy, their VP of personnel, who might take over Colbert's job. And they might very quickly end up looking around, having no one ready to take Colbert's job, and also Colbert retiring. And I can't imagine it's very easy to conduct a GM search in the middle of June after your roster's already been set.
My friend, thanks so much. Appreciate the time, as always.
Thank you, Steve. Always always happy to jump on with you.
Chris Mack in Pittsburgh. Reginald Walker in the final half hour today. Any complaints on your end? Just want to make sure we're covered with you.
No, the Flyers still stink. That's all.
You know, we can seek help for you. I mean, I think of Little Luke, and I think of Little Mark. And if they make a mistake, what are you going to do?
Well, for one thing, if they act out at home, I say stop being a Cowboy fan. That strains them right out.
Yeah, but they're division champs.
Doesn't matter.
You'd rather finish in last.
The standard is the standard.
So you'd rather finish last. All right, so we'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
18 years goes by fast, my man. Congratulations on a job well done. You know, post-career is pretty cool. I'll see you there, pal.
Ben, congratulations, brother. What a career, man. You did it. You went out there every Sunday and gave greatness to the game of football, to the Steeler way, and you earned a gold jacket. One day I'll be there when you're putting yours on, all right?
Congratulations, Ben, on your Hall of Fame career. You're one of the best to ever do it. It was an honor and privilege to have been your teammate for 11 years, but even more so to still call you a friend. You have so much to be proud of. Now go enjoy your retirement. You deserve it.
Seven, congratulations on the hell of a career, man. Wish you the best in the future and look forward to seeing you going into the hall, baby.
Hey, Ben, just wanted to congratulate you on a great career. Just so thankful that I was able to be there at the beginning and thought I was old then, and now we're both old.
You know what bothers me about all that? It really does bother me. That exact presentation was made at our staff meeting, except they kept inserting the word suit or Kevin. I'm like, what the? I mean, it was subtle, but. Yes.
F-O-U-L-E-D, that spells FALDA!
You know, I was a bit nauseated by it. I was like, what the heck's going on? Something seems wrong here. All right. No, Ben Roethlisberger retires. Not the one we were hoping for. All right, so it's okay. Different day, different story. So what's your schedule coming up?
Well, I've got Seals basketball back on the SBC Sports Live YouTube channel tomorrow night. senior night, yeah. Central Mountain.
There you go. There you go.
And then
Seals, are the Seals playing a little better?
Unfortunately, no. It's been a very tough year for the Seals. One win still on the year.
There's one particular player, obviously, I'm rooting hard for. So
yes. Yes. And he's done his best to try to keep things afloat, but it's been a tough go. But hopefully maybe they can get a W on senior night tomorrow night. And then Sunday, I'm back at the PA, Mike, for Bucknell men against Loyola.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Tough one last night to Navy. Navy shots, they were in this game, and I thought they could be, because Navy hadn't been playing that great, but then they got white hot in the second half.
Yeah.
Much like Indiana, 67% in the second half, and they just pounded Bucknell.
But last time it was Indiana, they just jumped him right away. It was 12-0. And like Dick and I are looking at each other like, you got to be kidding me. Like, really? It was what you worried about going in. Yeah, it's like, okay. Because I thought Indiana, after the loss to Michigan on Sunday, would try to come out like a house of fire. And could they stem the tides? Like, oh. Couldn't. All right.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 at 15 Hummels Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, best of new inventory, great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors guarantee. Trade-in's never been worth more. Not only that, it really is one-stop vehicle shopping for the life of the vehicle and all the vehicles you buy at Sunbury Motors. Great with inspections, routine service, tremendous, and they have the ability with all their diagnostics to do the difficult. They're great. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummels Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. All right, let's talk a little football now. Let's bring in my good friend Reginald Walker. Welcome back, sir.
How are you, sir?
I'm doing great. How about you?
I'm doing great. I have to admit, even though it's not my team, I'm a Titans fan, for those that don't know, it felt good watching my teammate, Robbie Gould, good as gold, send his team to the next round. That felt pretty good. I actually happened to have on at the time a Penn State Letterman's sweatshirt.
Yep.
And I flashed it to the people in the bar, and I said, that's my teammate, that's my teammate. So that felt pretty good.
Well, you know, it's interesting. Robbie doesn't have a shoe contract. Have you heard the story about his shoes?
No.
You'll love this. Okay? Doesn't have a shoe contract. You know, he's been in the league for, you know, almost two decades.
Yeah.
Okay. He played with you, so I mean, you know, he's been around a little bit.
I'm 40, and his birthday is in the same month, not the same year.
Yeah.
But that, if people want to do the math at home, there you go.
There you go. And so his dad played soccer with another guy who owns a place called Angelo's in Lancaster. So Robbie's always gotten his shoes from Angelo's in Lancaster. So the week of the game, he's like, the shoes he's been wearing are going to get worn out. And he's also a little concerned about the field. You know, it's January, it's Green Bay, it's going to be frozen, the whole deal. So he called Lawrence Tynes about, hey, you know, how'd you kick there when you beat the Packers? And he told him, hey, a little shorter run up, really plant it and go. So he gets all the Angelos, and he says, hey, guys, I need some shoes. So they sent him some shoes, and he didn't like the ones he got. Like, yeah, they're okay, but they didn't like just, you know, when you were playing Reginald, the shoes had to feel just right. So they overnighted one more pair to him to Green Bay. And he said, hey, now these feel good. And that's what he did. He kicked the doggone thing, went through, and now they're in the championship game.
I love that. That is awesome. Good for him. To be still doing it at that level, at our age, I'm happy for
at
him.
Your age.
That's right. That's right.
At your age.
That's it.
At my age, the goal is to wake up. All right. So. All right. So it's interesting. You talk about Ryan Tannehill. We have an interesting contrast in quarterbacks here in each championship game. You've got classic dropback guys in Jimmy Garoppolo and Matthew Stafford on one side, and guys that can flat-out move in Joe Burrow and Patrick Mahomes on the other side. We know that the Mahomes-Burrow thing is what everybody perceives to be, and I understand why, the trend moving forward. What do you see in these quarterbacks?
Well, I'll start with Joe Burrow first. I guess I'm going in alphabetical order. I didn't do that on purpose. It kind of worked out that way. It's I don't know. Maybe Joe put that in my brain. No, it's interesting. I think the defining characteristic for Joe Burrow, right, is the fact that he's unflappable, right? Yeah. You don't get to the NFL without the ability to make all the throws, right? Or at least, per se, have the arm talent to make a lot of the throws.
Right.
But you don't stand in the pocket, right? Because you're right, he can move. But he's generally, right, yeah, I'll put it that way, right? RPO, they're not running a whole bunch of RPOs.
Right.
But what he's doing, to stand in there and get sacked 9 times and never get to the point to where he's skittish in the pocket,
right,
that's unheard of. Like, that's an inhuman performance to me, right? So that's what he does. Obviously, exceptionally well. Then you look at a guy like Jimmy G. What I think about Jimmy G is I think he's got the best ability probably out of all of them, mm-hmm, to forget the previous play.
Right?
Because he's made some ugly throws, some near pick sixes, just all kinds of chaos.
Yeah.
But he's able to forget the previous play.
Right?
And so you have to give him credit for that, even though the previous play could be an abject disaster, right? Pick six, he goes right back out there and has a great drive because that's just what he finds a way to do.
Right.
Patrick Mahomes, his ability to create angles to make throws, right? And his ability to change the use of how he deploys his arm, right? Not only the arm slot, but when to put heat on it, when not to, on the same route,
right?
Like, yeah, he can throw the same over route as a dart or throw it with some touch depending on the situation. So his ability to adjust from that standpoint. And then Matthew Stafford, his ability to he puts fear in you because, and I know I said this earlier, everybody can essentially make every throw. The fear he gives you is he can make every single throw from the pocket with no time, right? Because his arm is so electric, it allows him to sort of, you're just afraid because he can do anything in any moment from a stationary position. And so you look at those four quarterbacks, and those are some of the things that stand out. I think what's interesting, and this, I'll say it this way, the sad part about this weekend is it will never
get to the level of last weekend. That's right.
It's not possible.
No, it can't.
It can't, right? No. But I think we're going to have two really good games. I think there's a couple other little storylines. A lot of people were talking about Matthew Stafford and how important it was for him to win playoff games. I think the heat right now is, I wouldn't say heat, but the eyeballs right now are a little bit more on Sean McVay, right? He's the play caller. Mm-hmm. He's the guy that said, Jared Goff couldn't get it done. I need a better quarterback when you got all the way to the Super Bowl with him. So if you lose with this group, Odell Beckham and Jefferson and Cooper Kupp and Higbee at tight end and Von Miller and Jalen Ramsey and Matthew Stafford, like, you got all these guys since that issue.
Well,
if you don't win now,
look,
hey, Sean, we might need to talk.
Well, the bottom line is they have no draft capital left.
That's right.
This is an all or nothing proposition with the Rams. All the heat's on them. They're home. They've built this alleged all-star team. They've taken their draft capital and mortgaged it. And meanwhile, the 49ers, I think, are playing with house money, and they also are playing out there with maybe of all the people we talked about. Kupp is terrific, but jeez, what do you think of Deebo Samuel?
I'm so glad you talked about Deebo Samuel. You know, he as a player, right? And the way they use him, the way they deploy him, right? The running game, the passing game, screens, slot stuff. Mm-hmm. The only thing we haven't seen him do is throw a pass, right?
Right.
On a consistent basis. And so it's just interesting for me to watch where and how he's deployed.
Yeah.
And it reminds me at times, right? You could think of a bunch of different players over the years. But for Nittany Lions fans, you can think back to the early 2000s when Zach Mills was running the offense and we had a guy named Michael Robinson running.
Yep.
Right? You got a guy at 235 pounds that runs. At the time, he was a sub-4-4 guy. But he was definitely a sub-4-5 guy, right?
Yep.
So you've got a guy running sub-4-4 at 230 pounds and has a rocket launcher for a right shoulder.
Yep.
Deebo Samuel, not as much of the thrower, right, but even more explosive and electric in the run in the pass game. And what he does is he gives you the ability to take the top off of the defense from anywhere he is on the field. He can take what looks like a 2-yard run and take it to the house. I also like how they deploy him in terms of the play calls. When you get a guy like that, who is that dynamic with the football, and then you pitch it to him so he can run downhill, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
He's not running to the sideline.
Right.
He's coming at your defensive front's face. What happens with that is they give you the action as if they're going wide, and he's coming downhill. So guys are trying to get to the next gap, and by the time they realize he's actually already coming downhill, they can't get back to their gap, and he's through it. And now all of a sudden, it's him against defensive backs, and it's a foot race.
Right.
Right? Because and 9 times out of 10, if Deebo Samuel's involved in the foot race, whoever else is in it, they gonna lose.
Yeah. Yeah, Michael Robinson. People forget in 2002, Larry Johnson was hurt before the Michigan game. And Michael Robinson was the starting tailback. You and I both remember that. He was the starting tailback. He also threw a touchdown pass at Illinois to Zach Mills. He scored the two touchdowns against Nebraska on those slot plays. And they put him in a different number in practice the day the TV guy showed up.
Yep. Just, I remember that. And you know, watching the way they deploy him, way we deployed him, right?
Yeah.
And now a guy like Deebo Samuel, the versatility and what it comes down to is when you get to this spot, you got to get the ball to your best players and let them make plays. Mm-hmm. And that's what, you know, the 49ers are doing an excellent job of doing. The other thing I like is, you know, this staff, they understand, they play very much complementary football.
Mm-hmm.
And a prime example of that, and I tell people this all the time, Steve, look, special teams may not win you a game, but it'll lose you one.
Yeah.
So you better take care of your special teams. And if anybody needs an example, just look at the end of all four games, right, this past weekend.
Yep.
And also how the 49ers even got to the point to where they could get Robbie on the field. They blocked a punt.
Yeah.
Special teams.
You got a touchdown.
Yeah. You got to play. The game is – and that's why, you know, as I'm going to get this in real quick because I'm hearing the Aaron Rodgers slander, right? They're saying he didn't get it done over his career. First of all, it's hard to win a Super Bowl. He's won one.
Yeah.
So let's calm down.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, yes, he's 11-10 in his career in the playoffs, but that's just because the record goes to the quarterback. The reality is the Packers organization is 11-10 in the playoffs in the Aaron Rodgers era, right? Because you have to win or lose as a team.
Yeah, exactly right. And now, in the team concept, when you watch Tyreek Hill, I'm spending a lot of time on speed here. I mean, my goodness. I mean, his footwork to go with the speed is remarkable to me. What do you think of him?
Well, two things. I think he does a better job of understanding how to pace himself than most players I've seen, right?
Yeah.
Because he knows when to really crank it up and he knows when to shut it down. I want to make another point, right? Because certain guys pump fear in you, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what Tyreek Hill does. Let's go back to the game on over the weekend, Sunday night. And you know where I'm going. Special teams.
Yep.
They randomly put him back there for a punt.
Yeah.
Right? Gunner runs out of bounds because he's like, I better get down there.
Yep.
Right?
There's also a penalty on the Chiefs. The first thing I said when they said there's two flags, I said it out loud.
Repunt.
I said, kick it, make them kick it to them again.
Yep.
You're going to kick that ball to Tyreek Hill 30 times in a row if you have to, because I'm giving him a chance.
Yep.
And what happens, he takes that punt all the way down inside the 20-yard line.
Yeah.
He's electric. His vision is phenomenal. What I like about him, if you really watch him, and I know the game is kind of legislating it a lot out, Tyreek Hill, as much as he goes over the middle and as small, he never gets hit hard. Never. He never takes a big hit. And you have to give him a lot of credit for that, because as fast as he's moving and all the things he's doing and the cuts and jumping and all these different things, he'll make a couple of cuts and look up and say, oh, there's a big guy behind me, and go down. And so you have to respect his ability to understand how valuable, right, of a commodity he is. They've gotten nothing out of, and I don't mean this in a bad way, it's just good he's playing football and staying out of, you know, having issues right now, but they've really gotten nothing out of Josh Gordon, right?
No.
A guy that some people thought maybe they would get something out of. They've gotten nothing out of him.
Right,
but
exactly.
Tyreek Hill, the Cheetah's like, man, don't worry about that. We got Kelsey up there, in there, and I'm over here, but then you give credit to guys like Byron Pringle making plays now, right? Mecole Hardman, that reverse he took to the house.
Yep.
Are you kidding me?
Right.
That speed. Like, they've got so many weapons, but you're absolutely right. It all starts with 15 Patrick Mahomes and 10 Tyreek Hill, and Tyreek Hill's ability to pump fear in your entire defense.
It's amazing. It all dovetails from there. And the safety valve is Kelsey. And if you want to double Hill, I can go to Robinson. I can go to Pringle. I can go to Hardman. There's a lot of options there.
Yeah.
And I'll give you one good one on punts. Penn State's in the Cotton Bowl, and everybody's like, oh, Memphis has great special teams. Okay? Just putting K.J. Hamler back there, they refused to punt to him. And Penn State kept getting great field position because they kept punting it out of bounds.
Yep.
You're like, okay. I mean, he didn't have to touch the ball, and he gave him great field position. Sorry?
Yeah, that was that.
Yeah. No, go ahead.
And for the record, I got disowned that day because I had to make a choice. I got a call from all of my family in Memphis that morning.
Yep.
And they said, you need to make a declaration right now. Are you Memphis or are you Penn State? I said, I love my city, but I wore the uniform. I'm all Penn State. We are, baby.
Yeah. And that's how we end it right now. Thanks, my man. Great to have you with us, Reginald.
Take care.
Reginald Walker. Refreshing to talk to somebody with no complaints. No?
Well, good for him to stick him with Penn State. That's the way to do it.
Yeah.
Because if he went Memphis, that would have been a total violation.
Maybe he's not from Philly. Are the only honest people out there from Philly?
No. There's plenty more.
Quite an admission on your part.
Only because I've lived in other places such as New York.
Boy, this explains why. Wow, you're depressed. Back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 W.
Ben, congratulations on a remarkable career. When you think about all the passing records that you have set, and more importantly, the fact that you took the team to 3 Super Bowls, brought home 2 championships, and you did this all with one team, the Pittsburgh Steelers, 18 years. When I think about you, you identify and you represent everything a Pittsburgh Steeler is. You played with grit, determination, and a degree of toughness. I congratulate you on a job well done, and without a doubt, in 5 years, I will see you in Canton.
There you go. The soup, by the way, lives by the words of Bill Cowher.
Yes, he does.
And I'm like, okay. He says, what do you think of him in the pregame show? I said, I don't watch the pregame show.
You, sir, are my hero!
I said, he might as well be talking to a wall. I said, I don't... So the answer is no, I don't. Yeah. I always love when they were, and Coach Cowher. He's not coaching anymore. He's Bill. All right. It's like, which game is he coaching? All right. Well, tomorrow we have on there the King. We'll be on the show tomorrow. We'll do our picks for the weekend. Mine are obvious. So.
Yes, they are.
Might as well go with what I said in August. We're going to keep it that way. So I don't even need to show up tomorrow. You two can do the show.
I think we can handle it if we could.
Oh, I know you could. I know you could. So. By the way, this would have been Art Rooney's birthday today, I believe. The Chief, a.k.a. the Old Man. Yeah, so. The players all loved him. I actually saw somebody, that was a couple weeks ago, saying, you know, for years that franchise was awful, and he didn't really do it. And I said, you know what, just, you know, slow down. We got to criticize everybody and everything. You know, it's okay to be happy. It's okay to sit there and look at somebody and say, you know what? You know, they did a heck of a job. You know, everybody loved them. When they weren't winning, they loved them. And when they were winning, they loved them. So there's got to be some reason for that. But some people are just bitter in life and have to criticize everything. By the way, how you doing?
Oh. Well, if you criticize the Roonies, then I got nothing for you.
So Ben Roethlisberger is retired. Still checking to see white smoke to see if the suit is retired.
And it's still black.
It is a dark day. All right. So Amy Schneider, huh? Jeopardy winning streak ended after 40 consecutive victories. She raked in better than $1.3 million.
Gone.
$1.3 million.
That's good, though.
She's gone to the bank.